Virgil Leesman was born on January 20th, 1922 in Hartsburg, Illinois. He and his wife Irma were married on September 13th, 1942, and on October 13th, 1942, he left for basic training in North Carolina.
Well, I had my basic training at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, with medium artillery. From there, I went to Hawaii, Oahu, and was hooked up there with Coast Artillery, 155mm howitzer, defending the north coast of Oahu for 6 months. And from there, I went to Australia. This is when the Japanese were, or they thought the Japs were going to land in northern Australia. So the division that we were attached to, which was the 24th Infantry Division, were sent up there for 6 months. Then we did a lot of amphibious training from Brisbane, Australia. And from there we went, and my first combat was in New Guinea. And then from there, we went to the PI with the Philippines. And I was with the third landing in Leyte in the Philippines. In Leyte, the Philippines, where they were bringing the Japs off of other islands to defend the island of Leyte. But one position, there were 12 of our guns in this battalion. We were credited with killing 13,000 Japanese. And after it was over with, a bunch of us guys got in the weapons carrier, and this was like 3 days. We get there and they were burying the Japs with like 18-foot bulldozers in big trenches, you know, feet to feet, pulling their dogs off, and covering them up. After the mission was completed there, and the turning point of the Pacific War at the Gulf of Leyte was determined by Leyte Gulf Battle of the both fleets occurred the third night after the landing. And they had a typhoon that night, and the battle, the two navies came together out the Gulf, the head of the Gulf that night, which is about 15 miles from where we were at. And then from that time on, it was just a matter of occupying places. But after that campaign was over, they went to Mindoro, which was another island in the Philippines. And the philosophy there was to acquire an airport and throw a circumference guard and just don't worry about the rest of the place. You know, just guard what you got. That was MacArthur's theory. Guard what you've got and protect that and use it as an aerial base. And then we went from there to down the Luzon, Subic Bay area, which today is your South Pacific headquarters of the Navy fleet for that area of the world. And then we went across the bay and did a lot of firing on Manila. And that campaign ended, and from there we went to Mindoro and set up another airport. And from that place on, we went down to Davao, which is in the southern Philippines, in Mindanao. Davao was a town in the southern Philippines where MacArthur took off from when the war started, and went to Australia. And we came in from the north and pushed him into the isthmus and acquired all that. And then, in the meantime, that's where the war ended. We were combat loaded to go to Nagasaki when the war ended.
Mr. Leesman's main job during World War II was the operation of the 155mm M1 artillery guns, or Long Toms. The Long Tom had a tripod base capable of being mounted on a firing platform, making it one of the most powerful and accurate weapons of World War II.
And just at one, just to give you an example now, of course, I was in the 155 artillery, that's 105mm, that's 6 inches. Shell 6 inches in diameter. Well, you could sit here at Hartsburg, and it's probably about between 7 and 8 miles between here and the courthouse in Lincoln. Well, now, it would be no problem at all to, for one of these guns to shoot, they could shoot 10 miles. A 100-pound shell, back in 1940.
Although Mr. Leesman didn't choose to go, he was able to see the value of an experience in the United States military.
I mean, I respected officers. I mean, that's not an either-or thing. That's it, you know. There's a lot of good from that particular training. I've seen it straighten out people, and by the same thing, that some people can't take that. But if you follow their instructions, I'm talking about safety and all this and combat, I've heard it said that you're safer in combat than you are, or your chances of dying are less. The statement is that more people would die in bed than anyplace else. But when we would, the first combat I remember we went to, the night before we left, I think, we were out there in formation. The supply brought in 10 crosses. There was 100, a little over 100 of us in the battery. So they had assumed that there was 10 of us that was going to get killed. So they put 10 crosses out there. I don't know. And our battery commander at that time was from Kentucky. And he was a salesman for farm machinery, captain. I still see him standing out there. And that's exactly what he said. You're safer in the Army here at home in bed. And if you follow the orders, we won't need any of them crosses.
While serving in the military, Mr. Leesman was thousands of miles away from his home, his family, and his wife, Irma. But this didn't prevent him from keeping in touch.
Well, we would try to write each other once a day. And at that time, I don't know if you're familiar with email. Well, that's what we used, a little about this square. And you'd be surprised the amount of stuff you could put on a little piece of letter. Because I wrote real little, and when I got here, I actually couldn't read it, some of it, I guess. But anyway, that's what I did. But that's not saying that I got a letter every day. A lot of times sometimes it was 6 weeks before you get a letter. But most of the time that you went from one place to the other was, for me, of course, it was by boat. Every time you get on a boat, it was 19 to 21 days. I would say I probably have 5 months on the water, and I wasn't in the Navy either. Came back to Los Angeles, went across the United States and back to Scotts Field where I was inducted and discharged and came home the 5th of November, 1945. I went into service on September the 13th and never was back home until the 5th of December, 1945. Irma and I were married a month before I left. She was 17 and I was 20. And on the 3rd, which was, we were married the 13th of September, and I left the 13th of October. And then she met me at Central Station in St. Louis. I didn't know her. I didn't recognize her, and she recognized me. And we reunited there, came home. And we'll be married 70 years this year.
Throughout his service, Mr. Leesman was surrounded by the death and destruction associated with war. The concept of what it means to take the life of another human being, a concept that he became all too familiar with, is something that weighs heavily on his conscience.
Could you shoot somebody? And a lot of people, you know, and maybe that's the way you think. No, I wouldn't have a problem, I'd just shoot a guy. Well, that's not true. To sit here and talk about it, and unless you, it comes to a point where it's either you or him, you then maybe shoot, but I've seen so many guys freak out that it's just impossible to do it. I don't know whether I could do it, but to train people to do this, that's where the training comes in to be very important, because if you don't listen to what they're telling you, you're not going to make it. If you do, it'd be by the grace of God. You've got a guy sitting up there in a coconut tree, you know, strapped to the tree, and you don't know he's there, and he sees you. That's what happened on the beaches in Leyte. They're sitting there on the beach and not be able to go anywhere, you know, hiding underneath the guns and not, or behind the tree or something, you know, for several hours, waiting to go. And I'm talking about thousands of people. not just one or two guys, tanks and artillery and whatever. And guys out front of soldiers, you know, come on guys, get out from behind the trees, we gotta go, you know. Well, and for some people, maybe it was their first time in combat. It's more than paperwork. It takes a lot of hard training. But we did it. I've seen guys, you know, on a firing line in basic training, and they teach you how to fire a rifle, they couldn't even pull a trigger. They'd get so nervous. And they always had somebody, one coach or another guy, you know. And I remember one fellow I was with, his hand just, he could not pull a trigger on, and just shooting at a target. And I remember reaching over, and the guns are loaded, you're firing target practice. And I pulled the trigger with my finger. Of course, the recoil just knocked him, and he was numb for quite a few seconds. But then you have, I don't know, I call them brave guys, you know, I can do anything, you know. And you always got those guys. And then when push comes to shove, I've seen them, they call it flip their lid, they'd lose their self-control and just basically go half crazy.
Mr. Leesman's experience with war has greatly affected his opinion on war and his conviction that it must only be a last resort.
No, I don't regret that I served, but I know one thing, I don't believe I would do it again. I say this with most respect to it. I mean, I don't know what I'd do. I would put up an argument, like I said before, there's got to be a better way. And I'm sure that there is. You're away from home 6 months, it's a long time. 6 years, a year is a long time. 2 years is a long time. But I don't know. I mean, we talk, Mom and I talk about it. And thinking about her here, you know, and what she went through for 40 months. And it's possible. And then talk about it 70 years later, that's something too. But I think, I know that people need to know these things. Just for instance, if you carry a K ration 6 miles, this is a true incident. In New Guinea, the airport, from where we landed, the airport was like 12 miles over really a rough terrain, which it was passable by Jeep, but it was so muddy Jeeps couldn't make it, so the people parachuted and took the airport. Well, to get supplies into them, which were the Navy brought in, that's where we were at. But we were able to fire on that distance. But the campaign was really over, so we were, if you carried a K ration, which is a box about this long and about this square, full of K rations, which was like about the size of maybe four Cracker Jack boxes each ration, that's about as big as it was. Two guys would carry that, and the mud about halfway up your knees. And the theory was, if you carry it halfway, which was 6 miles, and if you brought a Japanese prisoner back, which they wanted, the Japs didn't give up, they just shoot themselves. Or poor and all of them carried a couple of hand grenades, and they just pull a hand grenade and blow themselves up rather than be digging prisoners. But you could get, depending on the rank of the person that you, of the Jap that you acquired, but if you brought a prisoner back, you'd get 30 days in Sydney, Australia. Well, we went to 6 miles, and the closer we got to the 6 mile level, the more Japs we saw along, dead Japs, along the trail. And then we elected to go the second 6. Well, that was worse yet. You know, some of these guys had been dead for a week, you know, and every one of them, or not every one, but most of them had bayonet poked in them or some way, you know, justifying what they did to us, you know, and whatever, maybe felt like nothing, maybe we didn't even ignore them, but it, it was not a nice thing. But that was something that I never will forget that. I mean that.
Virgil Leesman currently presides in Hartsburg, Illinois with his wife. They are very close with their children and grandchildren. Mr. Leesman was able to take part in an honor flight to Washington, D.C. previous to the Memorial Classroom Project. He and many other veterans were flown to the World War II Memorial in Washington, D.C. free of charge. The honor flights, along with the Memorial Classroom Project, are ways for our generation to pay tribute to our great-grandfathers, grandfathers, uncles, and mentors' sacrifices. The courage of those who fought in World War II is remarkable, especially Mr. Leesman. He arrived in the Philippines when it was at the brink of disaster, but by the time he left, the Japanese army had been successfully subdued. Mr. Leesman prevailed through terrible circumstances for the well-being of millions of people he did not even know. Although he was victorious, Mr. Leesman's story has humbled our opinion on war. War is not a cause for celebration. The men who served are.